The Adventures of Greggery Peccary.
Oh, here comes Greggery, little Greggery Peccary, the nocturnal gregarious wild swine.
A peccary is a little pig with a white collar that usually hangs around between Texas and Paraguay, sometimes ranging as far west as Catalina.
This particular peccary is part of that bold new breed that extinguishes itself by markings which resemble a white tie directly below the white collar.
If it's wide enough, everyone will know that the tie I'm wearing is a symbol of how nimble my mind will grow.
Swing, suave. Drives his little red Volkswagen to the ugly part of town where they keep the government buildings.
Wooden.
Of a grim, gray, evil-looking building with a sign on the front reading, Big Swifty and Associates, Trendmongers. And what, might you ask, is a trendmonger? Well, a trendmonger
is a person who dreams up a trend, like the twist, or
flower power.
And spreads it throughout the land using all the frightening little skills that science has made available. One fateful morning, Greggery Peccary made his way through the Steno Pool.
Hi, Mildred. Hello, Gladys. Wanda.
Yes, from the moment they laid eyes on him, all the girls in the big Swifty Steno Pool knew here was a nocturnal, gregarious wild swine on his way up. A peccary of destiny, adventure, and romance.
Is there any mail for me? Or gizmo, wouldn't you rather be involved in a series of colorful time-wasting trends?
Air hockey, bit dush, book, bit.
Yo. Is your wife snoring by the sink? Your life boring, don't you think?
You.
Life is so much better when there's some little something to you.
Does it matter that this waste of time is what makes a life for you?
I must plummet boldly forward to my ultra-avant, laminated, simulated replica mahogany desk with a strategically placed imported very hip water pipe and the latest edition of the Whole Earth Catalog and rack my agile mind for a spectacular new trend, thereby rejuvenating our limping economy and providing for bored, miserable people everywhere some great new thing to identify with.
I've got your little toys, we're busy making them. Busy making them. Busy making them just for you. Woo-hoo-hoo. Highly efficient, Miss Snodgrass.
And with that, Greggery turned and strode nonchalantly into his dinky little office with the desk and the catalog and the very hip water pipe, and proceeded with a vigor and determination known only to piglets of a similarly diminutive proportion to single-handedly invent
the calendar.
With his eyes rolled heavenward and his little shiny pig hoofs on the desk, Greggery ponders the question of eternity and fractional divisions thereof, as mysterious angelic voices sing to him from a great distance, providing the necessary clues for the construction of his thrilling new trend.
Sunday.
Wow. Sunday, Saturday, Tuesday through Monday. Sunday, Saturday,
and thus last, the calendar in all of its colorful disguises was presented to the bored and miserable people everywhere. Greggery issued a memo on it, whereupon the entire contents of the steno pool identified with it strenuously and worshipped it as a way of life and took their little pills by it and went back and forth from work by it and paid their rent by it, and before long they were even having birthday parties in the office by it. Because now at last, Greggery Peccary's exciting new invention had made it possible for everyone to find out how old they were.
What hath God wrought?
Unfortunately, there were some people who simply did not wish to know. And that's why, on his way home from the office one night, Greggery was attacked by a rage of henchmen. Making his way through the evening traffic, Greggery notices that the other vehicles which crowd and bump his little red car are all inhabited by slowly aging, very hip young people. They appear to be casting sinister glances toward him through their glinting, acid burnout eyeballs, trying to run him off the road or make him bump into something, giving strong evidence of hostile aggression. To elude them, Greggery takes the short forest exit off the expressway. They zoom after him in all manner of cars, trucks, garishly painted buses, and motorcycles. Greggery takes a bumpy trail off the main short forest road, which leads him up the side of a famous and conveniently placed mountain, and into a strange cave on the edge of a cliff not far from a little twisted tree with eyes on it. Meanwhile, the enraged hunchmen
and hunchwomen
rumble through the short forest until, realizing the little swine has escaped, they decide to park their steaming vehicles in a circular pseudo-wagon train formation and have a love-in. Under the influence of a fantastic amount of trendy chemical amusement aid, they proceed to perform lewd acts, rip each other off for small personal possessions, and dance with depraved abandon in the vicinity of a 6-foot pile of transistor radios, each one tuned to a different station. The hunchmen finally expire from exhaustion, and Greggery, who has viewed the proceedings from a safe distance, breathes a sigh of relief.
Phew.
Only to be terrified once again by a roar of immense laughter. Which seems to be rumbling up from the very depths of the cave in which he has hidden his car.
Good Lord, what was that?
Greggery doesn't realize he has concealed himself inside the very mouth of Billy the Mountain. And as you all know, whenever Billy laughs, rocks and boulders hack up, and the air for miles around is filled with tons of dust, forming a series of huge brown clouds.
Who is making those new brown clouds? Who is making those clouds these days? Who is making those new brown clouds? Better ask the philosopher and see what he says.
Greggery stops at a gas station and makes a mysterious phone call.
Is this the old loft with the paint peeling off it by the Chinese police where the dogs roll by? Is this where they keep the philosophers now with the rugs in the dust where the books go to die? How many has got? So you's got quite a few just sitting around there with nothing to do? Well, I just called you up because I wanted to see a philosopher be of assistance to me.
Greggery receives information that the greatest living philosopher known to mankind is currently in possession of the very information in question. And furthermore, this information could be his if only Greggery would attend a special therapeutic group assembly. Classes now forming and available at a special low, low introductory fee. And now here he is, the greatest living philosopher known to mankind, Quentin Robert D. Nameland. Take it away.
Folks, as you can see for yourself, the way this clock over here is behaving, time is of affliction. Now, this might be cause for alarm among a portion of you, as from a certain experience I tend to proclaim, the eons are closing.
Checks payable to Quentin Robert D. Nameland, greatest living philosopher known to mankind.